We start. Good morning, everyone. I'm Andrea Perigo, and we will now present our work titled Beyond Body and Brain, Evolving the Sensory Apparatus for Voxel-Based Optrons. Work made by me and Giovanni Iacca from University of Trento and Eric Medved from the University of Trieste. So here the outline of our presentation. We start with the background, so we speak about the composition of the robot, the evolution of sensory apparatus, and the performance task. Next, we move on the result session where we propose three. We pose three research questions about the sensor effectiveness, the evolution of sensor, and what are the sensors preferred by the evolution. Next, we move on the last part where we speak about the possible further research direction. And we draw the conclusion. So,
excuse me, Andrea, we can barely hear you. Can you try and get close? We can barely hear you. Can you please get closer to the microphone or try to boost it up in some way so that we can hear you more clearly? Thank you very much and sorry for interrupting.
That's true. Give me a second. Now you hear me better. Yes. And sorry, more than here, I can. And now? Okay. Okay, sorry. And so start with a rapid overview about soft robots. Soft robots take inspiration from living organisms that present a body composed of flexible materials that allow a better compliance with the environment and humans. Soft robots are able to move on rough terrains and to squeeze on tight spaces. And for the reason, they have been proposed for gait rehabilitation and for medical analysis. But what are the components of soft robots? Like living organisms, we can divide the soft robot in three parts. The body, in our case, the voxels, the senses that are represented by the sensory apparatus, number, position, sensor in the robot, and the brain, which is the controller that takes in input the sensor readings and makes the body move. As regards the body, we use the 2D voxel implementation. The voxels are composed by four muscles arranged at each corner and linked by a spring damper system that allows them to change the area. This change is regulated by a parameter, rho A, which is a measure of the strength of the voxels. It indicates how much the voxel can shrink or expand with regard to its rest area. Finally, the voxels are bound together by rigid links composing the body shape. The second component is the sensory apparatus. Each voxel can be equipped with a combination of sensors used for sensor, the touch, the area, the leader, and the velocity. The leader is a vision sensor, and these sensors have a different dimensionality, meaning that they read a different number of values. This is particular, for example, the touch and the area read a single value, while the velocity read two values, one for each axis, and we configure the leader to read three values. This is particularly important for the brain, which is the last component of the robot, because it takes in input the sensor readings and produces actuation values for each voxel. In our case, we use the multilayer perceptron, and then we can completely describe it by its weight vector, and this will be used later as genome of our evolutionary algorithm. So, of these three components, the sensory apparatus is the one that is often overlooked. The sensors are based on design choices, and the controller is simply involved used. But what happens if the sensory apparatus can evolve? However, before answering this question, we need to answer another question, which is how to evolve the sensory apparatus. The genome, as we saw before, is a numerical vector, the weight vector, and this allows us to use CMAES. but the controller is strongly dependent on the sensory apparatus. A change on the number of sensors causes a change on the brain morphology. For this reason, we need a way to move from the numerical vector space to the solution space. And for this reason, we use the mapper. In particular, we developed two mappers that are based on maximal sensory configuration, meaning that we fixed the maximum number of sensors in the robot. And thanks to this, we have a fixed genome, fixed length genome. And the two mappers are the limiting and the unlimiting. The limiting mapper ranks the sensor based on their maximum weight and the number of fixed number. For example, if we have a simple robot with a single voxel and a maximal sensory configuration with three sensors, the touch, the velocity, and the area, with this simple genome, the limiting mapper will enable the touch and the area sensor. The unlimiting mapper instead works thanks to a threshold. So it compares its weight with a threshold. If they are greater than the threshold in absolute value, then the sensor will be enabled. In this way, we can enable all or any sensor of the maximal sensory configuration. The same example of before, but using a threshold of t equals to 0.3, we see that the multilayer perception that results by the mapper has only the area sensor. As regards the task, we implemented the locomotion task on an even surface composed of the alternation of three elements, hill, a gap, and even surface, in order to better investigate the sensing ability. Moreover, we used a single terrain for the evolution, and we tested each best robot each iteration on another terrain created with another seed. So now is where we can see that the columns indicate the different ratio values, the arches are the sensor readings, and the red lines are the ray of the leader sensor. So from this background, we move on the result part where we pose three research questions. The first, are sensors beneficial to robot effectiveness? Is the benefit of sensing ability somehow diminished by greater strength? In other terms, is it dependent on the robot shape? The second, can evolution discover an effective sensory apparatus? And finally, when the complexity of the Volvo apparatus is limited, what sensors are preferred by evolution? So in order to answer the first question, we evolved two shapes, a worm 7x1 and a biped 7x4 with a total of 22 voxels with three fixed sensory configuration that differs for the number of sensors enabled. In the figures, the sensors enabled are the one in red. Moreover, we test 8 values of rho A because we want to see how the strength of the voxel influenced the locomotion. We measured the average velocity in a time window of 3 minutes over 2,000 feet evolution. And these are the results. Where we can answer yes. The fitness, the average velocity, the locomotion ability of the robots is dependent both on the shape and the sensory apparatus other than the strength of the voxel. Moreover, we can highlight three aspects. The first one is that, as expected, the greater values of strength leads to faster locomotion, and this is true until values of 0.6, for values greater, we saw that the physical engine is not able to correctly handle the movement. And the second aspect is that the behavior of the two shapes is different. The worm has two peaks for the medium and the high configuration, while the biped has roughly the same distribution. The final aspect is that the difference between the training and the validation terrain is greater for the low configuration. And this indicates that the using the sensor allowed the robot to have to be more adaptable to new situation. And from these three aspects, and particularly from the second, we can conclude that there is not a fit for all configuration, but it depends both on the shapes and the strength of the box. And this leads to our second research question. Can evolution discover an effective sensory apparatus? To answer this, we compare the three fixed configuration with the two variable one, with a fixed value of rho A of 0.3 over 25,000 fits in evaluation. We set the limiting mapper to enable 20 or 30 sensors depending on the shape, and this is the number of sensors present in the medium configuration. While for the unlimited mapper, we observed the weight distribution of the high configuration in the previous case and selected 10%. Moreover, we initialize the weight vector to zero. In this way, the evolution starts with all the sensors disabled and used as maximal sensory configuration, the high configuration. These are the results, and even here we can answer yes. The variable sensory apparatus can find a configuration that are able to reach the same fitness as the fixed one. And this is particularly true for the limiting case where it uses which use a smaller number of sensors than the high configuration. Moreover, we can see two aspects, one for the worm and one for the biped. For the worm, we can observe that the medium configuration seems to be, this is the red line, seems to be slightly better than the other configuration. While for the biped, we see the strange behavior of the unlimiting that first increases, after decreases, then increases again. As regards the worm case, we observed the video and see that there are two types of population. The first one that vibrate at high frequencies, and the second that does not. We divide the population, plot the fitness, and seems that the one that vibrates are better. However, we observed, we tested these two population over a slightly more difficult terrain with a deeper gap and higher hill, and see that the one that vibrate are not able to overcome the obstacles, while the one that does not vibrate are able to overcome them. So we conclude that this behavior that the evolution finds, the shortcut, is not good behavior for the robot, as it's strongly dependent on the terrain that we use. As regards the strange behavior of the limiting of the limiting mapper, we see that this is due to the discovery of the sensor. In the first phase, where the sensor are not used, it increases using only the time function. Next, when the first sensor is discovered, the brain needs to be retrained. And for this reason, the fitness decreases. And next, when the brain is retrained to use the sensor, increases again. And this is also confirmed by this plot, where we can see that the population that does not use any sensor rapidly goes to zero when the, after the sensor starts to be discovered. Now we see a video of the the locomotion, where we compare the low configuration with the limiting and the unlimiting. We see that the biped at the end of the evolution is stuck by the first obstacles, while the unlimiting is able to easily overcome it, seeing it before. In similar way, the worm with the low perception is blocked by the uneven surface, while at the end of evolution, the worm with the limiting representation, and so using the sensors, is able to easily overcome the obstacle. Now, our last such question, that is, when the complexity of the evolved apparatus is limited, what sensors are preferred by the evolution? We answer this both from a quantitative and qualitative point of view. Quantitatively, we observed how many and which sensors remain disabled, while qualitatively, we observed what is the activation order in evolution time of the sensors. For the qualitative quantitative aspect, we see that on one end, the vision sensor, the LIDAR, seems to be the most preferred with 100% activation for both the shapes, while on the other end, the RF sensor seems to be the one that is more disabled, in particular for the biped. This can be due to two motivation. The first one is that this sensor is the most numerous, and so it's more probable that it remains disabled. On the other hand, it can be that, and what we think, the evolution is able to understand this information is redundant, and so maintaining it disabled in favor to enable other sensors. For the qualitative point of view, we see now a single run of the limiting case, where in green there is the fitness, in black the percentage of sensor used, and we selected four points that are important for the evolution. When the evolution starts, when the first sensor is discovered, a point in the maximum improvement, when the fitness increases more rapidly, and when for the first time all the sensors are enabled. In the upper part, we see the schema of the robot, where in each square indicates the voxel, and inside the square inside indicates the sensor. The first sensor from the left is the RF sensor, next is the touch. The two columns indicate the velocity sensor, one square for each component. And the next one is the LIDAR. Light gray indicates that the sensor is not present in the maximum sensor configuration. The black border that is present but is not enabled in that robot, and if it's colored in red, that the sensor is present and enabled. We see that in the phase of maximum improvement, the LIDAR sensors are all enabled, remarking the importance for the evolution of this sensor. Moreover, we can also show what I say before about the unlimiting case. When the first sensor is discovered, the fitness decreases rapidly, and next starts to increase again when the sensor has discovered the brain retrained. So, what can be other further research direction from this? Well, the first can be implement the map elites and quality divergent algorithm to better explore the solution space. Another can be to add split the energy constraint, so each sensor costs an amount of energy and the body has a total budget of energy. And lastly, can be the co-evolution of all the three elements of the robot, so the body of the brain, the sensory apparatus. And for example, we can start the evolution with the worm with the low configuration and end with the biped with the high configuration. Summarizing, concluding, in this work, we see how the sensory configuration directly affects the performance, how the evolution is able to generate equally capable controllers, and how the evolution learns what are the most beneficial sensors for the locomotion. Thanks for your attention.
Thank you very much, Andrea, for this very interesting talk. We have time for maybe one question, a couple of questions. Seems to be no question in the chat window. Anyway, first, again, I really appreciate that you people have posted your code on GitHub. So I think that using free software is essential. Okay. Gusti, please go ahead. Yeah.
Sorry, I was just raising my hand, but so. Thank you very much. This is really very thought-provoking, and indeed I very much like your last slide, which states what I was thinking all along your presentation. We should extend our framework and go beyond the joint evolution of the body and the brain and include the sensory apparatus in there. So that's really good. Two notes or a question and a note.
Yes, sir.
We should go beyond locomotion, and that's where everybody starts, okay? So papers that we are working on and everybody's working on start with locomotion, but especially with the sensory apparatus and all the extra features and functions you get, you could and should go beyond that, obstacle avoidance, navigation, and lots of other things. And the question is, how would this change if using sensors had costs? So there is no evolutionary cost on having or using many sensors. Do we have any idea about that?
The idea is that the energy as is the sensor, sorry, as a cost, the evolution should find a compromise between the configuration that uses more energy and the one that produces more a better locomotion and the one that produces a lower locomotion. I think that the result can be similar to the one obtained with the limiting, where there is not an explicit cost on the sensor, but the evolution have to decide what sensor maintain disabled.
Okay, so am I correct that it would be actually a multi-objective optimization problem, that you should minimize the cost for the robot?
Yes, also, yes, I think it should be a multi-object.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Thank you very much. I don't think there is any other questions, so let's just